machine has prepared for you, for me too. Our next speaker.
Oh.
Our next speaker is Mr. Michael V. Spindle-Watson. He is an ABE, all but dissertation, at George Mason in economics. He is very much a man of contradiction because he likes Austrian economics, ethically speaking, from how Friedrich von Hayek was decent. Ludwig von Mises was an inveterate atheist who hated Judaism and sneered at Christianity, surprised at how lively and vivacious and robust the Catholic, especially, and evangelical debates were. At the same time, Mr. Spindle-Watson is a contradiction because he loves Catholic social. So maybe next time we'll invite Michael Novak, who used to teach here at IWP, to excite Mr. Spindle-Watson, since we cannot no longer invite Friedrich von Hayek. He's dead. And he wasn't directly associated with us because he used to stay quite frequently at Mr. Bentley's house. You may be wondering about Bentley Hall next door. That's Mr. Bentley from Nevada. And he was friends, a good friend of Friedrich von Hayek. Mr. Spindle-Watson has regularly participated in various seminars on Austrian libertarian thought. He has published in the Quarterly Journal of Austrian Economics, and he has also spoken here. This is his second time. He's a historian. When I met him for the first time, he thought he knew everything. Now, I don't know, 15 years later, he's become much more humble, so he's reached the point that he knows that he knows nothing, which is a great improvement, and I would like to welcome him to tell us all about Paradisus Judaeorum in royal and or private cities of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. Or was it?
Yeah, so I remember actually in seventh grade, I told Professor Hodakiewicz I knew everything about Józef Piłsudski. When I found out he was a Polish historian.
And now you do, really.
Yeah, I found out I know nothing. But so several years ago, I presented on the Paradisus Judaeorum, the Paradise of the Jews in the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. There, I took the data that I compiled under Professor Markoyama and looked at how Eastern Europe was different than Western Europe in terms of persecution and expulsions. And we also looked at how weather, bad weather, a low temperature, which would create a negative income shock. When people are poor, they tend to attack their neighbors, or there is perhaps a greater possibility that they would attack their neighbors or expropriate them. We found that that correlation, which held in Western Europe, didn't hold in Eastern Europe, in the Commonwealth. The Commonwealth has a different institutional framework. And this talk, well, in my research, I discovered that a lot of historians talked about royal cities and private cities and the differences there. And so I began researching, and there's a debate, there's a difference between older Jewish historians and newer Polish, or older Polish Jewish historians and newer Polish Jewish historians. And I quote Antoni Polański from The Jews in Poland and Russia, quote, "Contrary to the view of older Jewish historians, most notably Simon Dubnow, which characterized the owners of the towns as eccentric and arbitrary, the town owner of Opatów was quite rational in his behavior, seeking what was best for the town. He was also on occasion supported the Jewish inhabitants. Meyer Bauerbahn, this is a historian before World War II, wrote, each caprice or ill humor of the town owner could result in the worst unhappiness for the Jewish individual or even the whole community. Bernard Weinrib wrote in The Jews of Poland, this is probably, I think, one of the best books on the topic in the English language. I highly advocate anyone to read it. Rossmann's case studies are excellent too, the Lord's Jews, which I have to get out of my backpack later. many, so quote, many Jewish historians accepting the general trend of Polish historiography since the 19th century try to emphasize, usually out of proportion, the arbitrariness of some landlords in their handling of Jews, as if to outweigh any favorable view of the nobility, or as though they were ideologically opposed to the concept of nobility in general. And here he's talking about the anti-noble bias in the positivist historians of the late 19th century. But one cannot do otherwise than admit that in the private cities and towns, the legal situation of Jews was better than in royal cities. You know what, this is the setup I have here. Let me change it really quick. There should be a way of the presenter's view. I need the presenter's view.
See, better is the enemy of good.
Yeah, the problem is I have several notes here in my
You know what happens in our seminars? I always ask you to run this.
Why is it not showing me the presenter's view? Okay, let's see if that works. I'm clicking presenter's view. It's not giving me presenter's view.
You know that old Yankee proverb, if it ain't broke, don't fix it.
If it ain't broke, don't fix it, right. Great. I apologize for this. Yeah. I don't know why it's showing up there. I'm pressing the button for it to show up, but it's not showing up.
Oh, it's disconnected.
Is there anyone out there who can help me with this, or?
Help me, but I'll find the body.
Okay, so I got that back, but how do I, well, it's not giving me, this presenter's view is clicked, but it's not actually giving me presenter's view, which means I can't see my notes. Hold up, let's see what happens. Oh, I got it, okay. Presenter's view, that means I see what the next slide is and all that kind of stuff. Okay, well, let me continue. So, when I was reading these different histories of the Poles, of Jews in the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, I found a lot of detailed anecdotal accounts, which are great case studies. You need lots of case studies. However, as an economist, sometimes we like to see aggregate statistics. We like to be able to compare using stats and do some type of statistical analysis. So I went about and used the data we had and did that. And thus, the question to determine is, where did Jews have it better off? Do they have it better off in the private cities or the noble cities, according to the statistics I put together? Of better off means they lived in peace without persecution or expulsion. Persecutions are violence, pogroms, riots, and the like. Expulsions are when a Jewish community is thrown out of a town or city. Now, with expulsions usually occurred, often in the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, sometimes an expulsion could be classified from something called a non tolerandus udaeus, which is where the king granted a privilege to one of the towns or cities to exclude Jews from settling within the city. Often, there were actually no Jews within the city. It was given often to ecclesiastical towns, that is a town that is owned by the clergy or the church, and so it wasn't really an expulsion because there were no Jews there. What also often happened in these ecclesiastical towns was the Jews would live in the suburbs, where that was outside of the jurisdiction of the city. So the question I'm asking is whether private towns experience less persecution expulsions than royal towns. But before going to the statistics and all that, let's look at the institutional historical framework that was the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth and the religious freedom of that country. So what were differences between Poland, Lithuania, and the rest? Well, Poland, Lithuania was a multi-religious, multi-linguistic, multi-ethnic monarchy that developed into a republic of nobles. The king took the Jews under the personal protection, and many Jews became useful to the king of Poland as minters, financiers, and managers of royal properties. And religious pluralism and freedom was a law, and many different ethnic and religious groups had privileges and protections. But remember, religious pluralism, freedom today is very different than it was back then. Then it was categorized under the estates. That means you had the peasants, you had the nobility, you had the clergy, the church, you had Armenians who and Tatars who were Muslims. You had Muslims in the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. You had Presbyterian Scots. You had the Socinians, which brought back the Arian heresy of the early church. The nobility could more or less choose whatever religion they wanted. The Jews were an estate unto themselves, with their own privileges. So today we can switch religions and do whatever we want nowadays. Back then, if you switched to becoming a Jew, that would be a problem. If you were a Jew switching to become a Catholic, you were ennobled. And there were some situations where Jews were ennobled, which is very strange, right? That didn't happen in Western Europe, but in the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, there are examples, very few, but there are examples where a Jew would become ennobled. And then there was a debate: is this Jewish nobleman, should he be held accountable in a noble court or in a Jewish court? And of course, there were ecclesiastical courts, there were royal courts, there were. This is the Middle Ages and the early modern period. There is radical decentralization compared to what we have today. So, it all began in 1264 when Prince Bolesław the Pious of Great Poland and Kalisz gave the Jews a charter, the Statute of Kalisz, putting them under his jurisdiction, not that of any city, ecclesiastical, or other court. Of course, before 1264, you do have Karaite Jews in the Ukraine, in Kiev and in Lviv. However, 1264 is the beginning of the emigration of Ashkenazi Jewry into the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, or Poland. This charter became the tradition of the Commonwealth. It was confirmed by King Kazimierz the Great in 1364 and 1367, King Władysław Jagiełło in 1387, in Lithuania in 1388 and 89, and other monarchs in 1453, 1539, and 1765. And this was the established tradition until the late 18th century. Even when the nobility, who had their own private courts, had their own lord courts within those private towns, they followed that tradition that was established. So the Statute of Kalisz gave established a Jews judge, as the Jews had their own court system, which enforced Jewish law. Jurisdiction included cases of Jew versus non-Jew. Jewish and Christian witnesses were required if a Christian took a Jew to court. Jewish defendants were tried according to Jewish law by the Jews judge. A Christian who murdered a Jew suffered greater punishment, the established punishments as well as confiscation of his property. And a Christian who wounded a Jew had to pay a fine to the prince or king in addition to damages to the victim. Now, of course, in this time period, this is a tradition, and it becomes interpretive. There's a variety of interpretations throughout Poland and throughout Lithuania. So, and often localities would interpret these laws according to their situation or according to whatever interest groups were there. The Statute of Kalisz established inviolability of person and property, freedom to travel, could not discriminate against Jews, that is, mean charge higher tolls to Jews, although there are examples of this. And the landlords, when Jews were working for the landlords, carrying their grain to Gdańsk, sometimes there'd be complaints that Jews would have that were being we have to pay tolls, and the landlord would intervene upon their behalf. Desecration of Jewish synagogues and cemeteries was punishable. Protection of Jewish funeral processions, ritual slaughter, and it disallowed non-Jews from collecting debts from Jews on the Sabbath. It also prohibited the charge of the blood libel, cited the papal bull of Pope Innocent IV in 1247. However, Pope Innocent. Papal bull was not listened all throughout Europe, and neither was this the prohibition of the charge of the blood libel. However, the king would show up once in a while, lop some heads off for folks persecuting Jews, or he'd fine them, throw them in jail, or free the Jew if the Jew had been thrown in jail and was under suspicion of the blood libel charge. Jews were freemen attached to the treasury, which is analogous to the Jews of Western Europe. So when the Jews come to Poland, they try to institute some of the privileges they had in Western Europe. However, in 1236, Jews start becoming called chamber serfs, servi camerade. Western theologians describe it as servitus iudaeorum, serfdom of Jewry. This never occurs in Poland. Poles are never described as chamber serfs. What this meant, chamber serfs and the serfdom of Jewry, is that in the West, Jews are treated as the property of the king or the prince, who may expel, rob, plunder, pawn, or cancel debts owed to them, owed by him. And when Jews were expelled from those towns, you would see the prince would all of a sudden say, I owe no more debts, because I expelled the population, I owe the debt too. Kings Władysław Jagiełło, Kazimierz IV, and Alexander explained their protection and toleration of the Jews was in accord with God's law, not because Jews were the king's property. This tradition of religious freedom is, as you'll later see when I go through some of the anecdotes on the private towns, was alive in the nobility of the Commonwealth, and they would, when discussing about the Jews, would talk about how religious freedom was the tradition of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. So the official status, legal status of Jews was that of freemen, like knights and gentry or burghers. They had the right to take an oath on a Torah. I've discussed the decentralization of the Middle Ages. Jews were also allowed to keep and bear firearms. And what does the right to keep and bear firearms mean? Traditionally, historically, it means that you're not a serf or a slave. This goes back to ancient Greece, where if you had the right to keep and bear arms, you were a citizen or a freeman. The king intervened to protect the Jews when persecuted. There were times when folks got away with, say, persecution of the Jews, but this was often the exception and not always the rule. But remember, we're talking about variation at the local level, which in Kraków was very different than Poznań, which was very different than Lwów. In Lwów, persecution of the Jews was rather low. In Kraków, there was a lot of strife. A lot of that strife was due to competition between the guilds, who can only be Christians, and the Jews, who cannot be part of the guild, which is, I would argue, is analogous to union and non-union labor. If you have union labor, they're often in competition with non-union labor. The union is either going to try bringing in that labor within the union, or they're going to try excluding them from the labor market. Jews cannot become part of the guild, and thus the guild, who often ran the cities, tried excluding them from their jurisdiction within the city. The king would also grant non totandus iudaeis on occasion to some towns, usually ecclesiastical towns. The church. So for a variety of economic, political, and religious reasons, the synods of the church wanted to completely segregate Jews and Christians. And one of the reasons they gave was that Poland was a young Christian nation, and that a foreign religion such as Judaism would perhaps corrupt this young Christian nation. Their synods were ignored, mostly, were practically ignored. It was against the laws of the king. The clergy themselves didn't follow them. If you look at the monasteries, if you look at the ecclesiastical towns, they willingly and often had good relations with the Jews and traded with them. Of course, Jews had good relations with the king. They worked for the king, and they were able to lobby and have the king protect them from persecution. The Statute of Colleges established the Council of the Four Lands. And if some of you may recall this from several years ago, there is a little bit of overlap, which, once we get to the next slide, it's going to be royal versus private. The Statute of Colleges also granted the Jews the Council of the Four Lands, which is an autonomous organization that paid taxes to the monarch, and often excluded Jews from paying taxes in the royal towns and cities. And so this creates a lot of conflict. Why? Because imagine you have part of your town that doesn't pay taxes to the local government, while another portion does. Jealousy and animosity breeds. And there were several towns where the Jews agreed to pay the local taxes, and after that you have no persecutions. And so it seems like that animosity, perhaps what the Christians probably saw as a double standard, affected the public order of the community. Whereas in the private towns, Jews paid taxes, like the Christians, to the landlord. The Council of the Four Lands was a judicial, political, religious, and charitable institution. It established, they had their own courts, the Kehila and the Kehilot, and they were a charitable institution. They established a social safety net. And so when there was a persecution, when there was an expulsion, when there was the Khmelnytsky insurrection in the Ukraine, the Jews would organize to help their fellow Jews through the Council of the Four Lands. In noble towns, the Kehila worked often very closely with the noble owner toward the common, toward what I would argue is the common good. So royal versus private. Before 1539, if you are a Jew living in a private town, you can appeal any type of judgments made by the Kehila, the Jewish court, to the royal court. In 1539, the king transferred jurisdiction of the Jews living to private towns to the nobles. So now, rather than appealing to, as a Jew, instead of appealing to the royal court, you would appeal to the landlord's court, which was the same as the other folks who lived, as the Christians who lived in the private town. So now Jews and non-Jews both appeal to the noblemen. There are two sorts of Jews legally then: private Jews and royal Jews. The king was overlord. However, he was usually, frankly, just ignored unless something egregious occurred. One example was when the general or the hetman of the Russian or Muscovite military switched sides. He came to the Polish side or the Polish-Lithuanian side, and the king gifted him a private town or a royal town that became his own. First thing he did is he put all the Jews in prison. The Jews in the area, freaked out about this and got Queen Bona Sforza to show up and say, well, in Poland we do things, or Lithuania, we do things a little differently. The Jews have rights. And so he released all his Jews that he had put into the prison, and then he started interacting them like any other Polish nobleman. He assimilated to the traditions and the culture and expectations of a nobleman in the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. Private towns blossomed in the 16th and 18th century, and Jews moved en masse, especially to the Ukraine. Jews often were employed by the magnates and owners of towns collecting taxes and rents and managing estates. And so they were able to, whether it be a view of lobbying or of communicating the problems or solutions toward that particular private town. Though Jews were legally protected by the king, and the king often had a financial incentive to protect the Jews, the relationship between Jews and noblemen became stronger due to proximity and scarcity. If you need to get the king to come and intervene, the king has a lot of things going on. He's got many royal towns. He's off far away, either in Kraków and Warsaw. He has to run some foreign policy. He has to deal with the same in the Senate. Whereas often the noblemen who owned these towns would travel throughout the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, visiting all their estates. And so often he'd be in your town and you could go talk to him, or you could talk to his manager. Often the manager was a Jew himself, so if there was a problem, you could deal with it quite quickly. The owners of towns also wanted immigration to increase, right? So because more residents means more taxes. Whereas in the royal towns, if Jews immigrate there, they don't pay taxes. So that royal town, the people who run it, the guild, aren't very interested in Jewish residents immigrating there, because at least for financial reasons. Where in the private towns, the noblemen would purposely create policies that would encourage Jewish immigration into their town. So they would say, you move here, no taxes for 10 years. I think some countries do that with foreign corporations nowadays, where they offer those type of tax incentives. Also, often the Christian guilds would also, in their attempt to regulate the market in a monopolistic manner, would attempt to exclude Jews, even though it was sometimes against the laws of the king. So when it comes to the privileges throughout the Commonwealth that were given to Jews, whether they be in royal or private towns, in royal towns, they were more uniform. In private towns, they were much more tailored to the locality, to what the landlord thought was best, and there was more variation and experimentation. Perhaps entrepreneurship would be the word. Each noble town, while following the tradition established by the Polish monarchy, gave privileges to each Jewish community independently and there was some variety, usually more tailored to local customs. Often Jews were also the co-founders of these towns. So with royal towns, often the Jews were immigrated into these towns, and they were not the co-founders, they were not the founding fathers. Where in the private towns, they were the co-founders, along with the Christian burghers or the Christians in the area, and the landlord. They sometimes financed these. So they were part of that community from its get-go. So what did this mean? In terms of immigration, half of the Jews in the world lived in Poland-Lithuania and Ruthenia in the 18th century. They, from their free choices, it can be determined that Poland was the paradisus iudaeorum. 3/4 of Polish Jewry lived in private towns and villages. 2/3 of Polish Jewry lived in private towns. Thus, 1/4 of the Jews in the world lived in private towns in the Commonwealth. I think that's a big factor right there, that's the evidence. Would Jews move in mass to private towns and villages if noblemen were eccentric and arbitrary in their rule, as Dubnov claims? Another way of putting this is, if Jews, like other men with families, careers, and property, prefer peace, security, and prosperity to violence and poverty, then we can determine from the choices that Jews freely made that the noblemen's towns and cities provided better living conditions and opportunities than royal towns and cities. And I think it's fair to say that most people like or prefer security and prosperity and peace to violence and poverty. And so from their free choices, and Jews were freemen, they could immigrate anywhere within the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, they en masse chose the private towns of the nobility. And so here's a nice map to change it from the words. This is 1764. The darker colors, that is a dark red, is where Jews, the density of Jewish population. And you'll see, where do Jews mostly live? That's southern Poland, western Ukraine. And that's where that's where there was many private towns being set up in the 16th to 18th century.
Where is Lwów
on
that?
Lwów will be, it's gonna be, you know what? I can't actually read it, but it's somewhere around here.
Further out. You see Krakow?
I can't see anything.
Right here. Oh, jeez.
Krakow is here.
So this is right here.
Lwów is right there?
More or less, yeah.
So it's in the darkest.
Yes, yeah. So why did Jews move to private towns? Well, landlords wished to develop and populate their estates. Tax breaks and legal incentives were created to promote new immigration. Quicker and often direct contact with the landlord when problems arise allowed for a lot of the problems to be quickly solved rather than the expensive proposition of lobbying the king. And the profit motive is directly linked to residency, which was not so in most royal towns. Jews were often better included in municipal government, or more likely that another way of saying it is the kahila co-ruled with the Christians. One may think of Jews in a private town were not two towns living in one town. It was one town with two different boroughs co-ruling together. So now that we've gone through the institutional framework, the history, let's go look at some examples. The Sieniawski Czartoryski magnates referred to their Jewish residents as townsmen, mieszczanin, or citizen, obywatel, the same terms they used for their Christian residents. They obviously made the distinctions legally between Jews and Christians. However, when they looked at those Jewish residents and Christian residents, they saw them as the townsmen and the citizens of their towns. They were not some lower class citizen. Obligations and rights were similar between Jews and Christians in Dzierżony, Między, Buż, and Sieniawa. If you give me 1 second, I will. I'd actually like to read some of them out to you because it's. And when I'm reading these out, think about the differences and the similarities. All property owners, whether Jew or Christian, or renters, had to pay the property tax on their homes or stores. For example, in Sieniawa, a Christian border paid 12 grosze, a Jew paid 1.5 złoty. The Jews paid a little bit higher of a tax. In Mienzebuz, a Christian paid a flat 2.5 złoty for his home, regardless of size. Jews who owned the larger homes paid in proportion to size 2 złoty to 8 złoty. All householders had to pay a fee for the right to fish in the magnate's pond, and those who owned livestock paid for pasture rights in the magnate's meadow. All householders were required to participate personally in maintenance work on town walls, bridges, roads, and so forth. All households had to contribute some time and equipment to projects such as hay cutting and baling, grain harvesting, and transporting the magnate's fish, honey, and grain. Jews usually had the option of hiring a substitute. All householders had to maintain firearms and participate in the defense of the town. All householders were responsible for fire prevention, to be split between the kahila and the Christians together. Christian householders had to pay a honey tax. That's the one tax that Christians pay that Jews own. And I couldn't figure out why this honey tax was a... Do you know anything about this honey tax? I couldn't figure out where it came from.
There probably was some kind of religious prohibition about... this is my wild guess.
Okay.
Religious prohibition against honey, that's number one. Number two, beehives have to be kept outside of city limits for obvious reasons. So if the Jewish population lived inside, you wouldn't expect them to have to pay that tax, no?
Okay. Yeah. Another important thing is frequently millers, shoemakers.
That's the beauty of micro studies. That's what you do.
Frequently, millers, shoemakers, tailors, furriers, and weavers were required to provide the magnate with a specified amount of free material labor. Note, there's no distinction between Christian millers and shoemakers and Jews. Often in the royal towns, the royal town would say a Christian cannot or a Jew cannot be a shoemaker, or it can't be a tailor, or it was heavily restricted. Where in these towns, there is no distinction that was made. A Jew or a Christian could pursue whatever life they saw fit. And Jews were often warned to serve good quality liquor and to pay the required liquor tax. That was probably because the nobility had the monopolistic right to produce liquor, and they would rent that, and they would rent that often to Jews at taverns to produce liquor.
Farm it out.
What?
The English word is farm out.
Farm out.
Not rent.
Rent, farm out.
Yeah, right.
Tax
farming. Farming.
Okay. So, at the founding of Oleszczyce by nobleman Hieronim Szyniawski, Hieronim wrote, "The Polish crown flourishes as it is composed of people of diverse estates, particularly in regard to their religious allegiance, on the principle that no authority shall exercise power over faith, honor, and conscience. We wish, therefore, to secure a peaceful life, especially to those persons who have suffered persecution, not because of any crimes or evil deeds, but for other reasons, so that they may enjoy the liberties of the laws enacted by us." That kind of sounds a little bit like the American founding in religious liberty. Now, one thing that's important in this quote, this is the 17th century, and this is from, it's either from this book, The Lord's Jews by Rossmann, or it's the other one that's about Opatów. Yeah. It's either that one or this one. I don't remember which one. So in this quote, you'll see the Polish. Now, the nobleman doesn't have to necessarily, it's his own jurisdiction, but he invokes the Polish crown. That is, he's following the tradition established in 1264 by Bolesław the Pious. And so that tradition is encapsulated in the towns, the private towns of the Commonwealth. So this one is from Opatów. So the last quote is from Rossmann. This quote is from Hundert. Paweł Karol Sanguszko, owner of Opatów, Prince.
Closer to the Rurik family than the Romanovs. It's not a joke. It's a real deal.
Prince Paweł Karol Sanguszko, owner of Opatów, declared the Jews declared to the Jews there, because in a well-ordered state the whole population depends on the elders of the Kehila, while the elders are in their turn elected by the commonality. Therefore, we undertake that the elders of this said synagogue of Apatush should be freely elected every year according to the Jewish laws and customs without any interference from the lordly power. End of quote. Institutional religious freedom, that the institutions that Jews had are free from the meddling of any higher authority. Of course, you know, the world isn't perfect, but the private lord would sometimes interfere, though sometimes the private lord would interfere, often for the benefit of the community, when he believed that the public order and peace were not being pursued by the Kehila. And remember, these owners are interested in profit and long-term profit. And so public order and peace result in long-term profit. So now you've had some anecdotes, you've had some reflection on the history and the institutional framework of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth in regard to Jews. Let's go into some stats and regressions. So the type of regression I did was a standard binary logistic regression using dichotomous data. That means an expulsion is a 1 and no expulsion is a 0, or a persecution is a 1 and a no persecution is a 0. My sample size is 181 cities and towns and villages with Jewish communities. I have about another 30 to add to that. It's on a different Excel spreadsheet. I just haven't had time to incorporate it. One set of regressions uses data from all years, and another excludes 1640 to 1660. And 1640 and 1660, that's the time of the Khmelnytsky insurrection until the end of the deluge, Potop. And this is a time of, you know, the Ruthenian peasants with the Cossacks do an uprising in Ukraine that even goes up to the areas of Belarus and parts of southeast Poland. The Swedes come, the Muscovites come. It's a time of guerrilla warfare, of massive destruction. And if you include those as persecutions, you're including really wartime democide, right, or genocide. It's a different, you know, the norms of the Commonwealth are not exactly working at the moment. It's a time of chaos. My variables, my independent variables are private city versus royal city. My dependent variables are persecution and or expulsions. My data sources, the first one is, you can find it online, it's very handy for any scholars out there. The Słownik Historyczno-Geograficzny Ziem Polski w Średniowieczu, the historical geographical encyclopedia of Polish lands in the Middle Ages. The second one, the Geographic Encyclopedia of the Polish Kingdom and Other Slavic Countries, is published between 1880 to 1890. I'm hoping that there's some new geographic encyclopedias that come out on this, because that's the best one I could find. And it's written before World War I, which is a Polish that I have difficult understanding. So I actually, when I was reading this, I asked my girlfriend, who's fluent in Polish, to come over. I'm like, what does this mean? Just, I don't know. And then my mother, who's sitting in the crowd, I asked her, Mom, what does this mean? And she said, I don't know. And my mom did an MD in Poland, so she's a native speaker. And so I'm sitting down, we're going through all the definitions in the different dictionaries, and then, you know, the definition of the medieval Polish. And finally, I started figuring out, okay, what this is all meaning. I also use Encyclopedia Judaica, and when those failed, I would often just use books like this. A lot of good information in here. And if I really couldn't find information on a Jewish community, I would actually visit the city website, which usually didn't have much info on there, but sometimes it was very detailed, listing all the different owners and even some the relations with the Jewish community. So out of those 181 towns and villages and cities I have, 7 were ecclesiastical, duchowe, 86 were private, 88 were royal. So about a 50-50 split. When we look at some of all persecutions and expulsions, we have 13 in private communities, where I'm excluding 1640 to 1660, because if you include 1640 to 1660, it's private towns that are usually much smaller than the royal towns. Everyone leaves them, or there's a lot of bloodshed that takes place in them. So in times of peace, the private towns experience 13 expulsions or persecutions. The royal towns and cities experience 61. And the ecclesiastical experience 2. However, those two those were expulsions, from what I remember, and they were probably more related to the town being granted the privilege of non terrandis iudaeis, which, but there weren't any Jews in that town yet, so it's a little different. The ecclesiastical town is not in my regression because there's so few ecclesiastical towns in my data set that it wouldn't result in any results.
So what is the period again? I'm sorry.
So my data looks between 1300 and 1750. And this is not complete. This is a work in progress, but this is what I have so far. I still have another 30 towns and cities to include in this data, but I think from the descriptive stats, it looks like private towns are much more peaceful and much more conducive to Jewish life. So when I ran my regressions, the first one, my dependent variable is expulsions. I had one statistically significant result in this whole process, but in every regression, it showed that it was a less likely chance that in private towns there would be an expulsion or a persecution. And it was much more likely that in a royal town you would experience a persecution or expulsion. So in here again, I did not include 1648 to 1660 because it spews out gibberish. So here, and then the royal town for an expulsion, 1.7 times more likely. In a private town, 87% less likely. For persecutions, a royal town, and this is my statistically significant result, a royal town, 2.2 times more likely, a private town, 30% less likely that a persecution would occur. Now, when I bring together persecutions and expulsions into the same dependent variable, with all years, you'll see that still the private towns less likely, that's 15% less likely. The royal two times more likely. When you take out 1648 to 1660, the royal stays practically the same because royal towns didn't suffer as much as the private towns between 1648 and 1660. The private towns suffered the most, and so when you take out those persecutions, those suffering, the bloodshed that took place, you'll see that there's a 60% less likely chance that persecutions or expulsions would happen in a private town. And then, this was more for fun, I need to look at population as a variable, and so when I took out the population centers, I found that there is a decrease in the likelihood that royal cities would experience a persecution or expulsion. So here we have, in royal towns, it's twice more likely to have a persecution or expulsion in a royal town, where now it's 1.16 times. And all the major population centers were royal cities. So, conclusion and future work. I'm expanding my database as it goes. My tentative conclusion is that private cities best capture the tradition of the tradition that Bolesław Pius started and the paradise of the Jews was best practiced in private cities relative to royal cities. I talked about my population variable, and then what I was also thinking about doing is looking at towns and cities and the Protestants and the different non-Catholics who live in those towns and cities and seeing perhaps there's some type of correlation between towns that had Protestants and Jews and Catholics, maybe experiencing less persecution versus towns that are more homogenous. Of course, I imagine that private towns will also work better for the Protestants because so much of the nobility, a third of the nobility went Protestant at one point, and so the Radziwiłł family, the Hodakiewicz family, were Calvinists at one point and they sponsored them. Here's a map. What's going on here? There we go. A map of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, and that's the end of my discussion. I will now open it up for Hodakiewicz to pontificate on my my presentation. Oh, great.
Thank you. First of all, this is a tour de force, brilliant. I really am delighted that we are rehabilitating feudalism, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, indeed, the great lords were rational. They liked to make money, too. They were just not capitalists. They were not banksters.
Crony capitalists.
They also had a paternalistic streak in them, which carries on until this very day. When the SS Sturmbannführer Daneke asked the king of Bulgaria, who, by the way, in Bulgaria goes by the name of Boris Sachse-Coburg-Gotsky, his real name is von Sachse-Coburg-Gotha, to deport Jews to be gassed in Auschwitz, the king said, by the way, no, because they're all my children. Basically, that's how feudals approach the world. Everybody is a child. There is a modern whiff of paternalism, which modern people hate. Not egalitarianism, but hierarchy. I have a few comments. First of all, as the Commonwealth developed its institutions, the Jewish community was one of a number of separate communities that enjoyed autonomy. The Council of Four Lands was one thing, which ran Jewish affairs. Jews even established their own taxes. But there were other communities which enjoyed the same sort of an autonomous existence and institution. And the context is important. So Scots, who were Presbyterians, had their own separate institution. And in every town where there were Scots, they enjoyed autonomy and similar arrangements to the Jewish community. So did the Tatars, who were Muslim. And so did the Armenians, who were of the Armenian rite, but there were also divisions within the Armenian confession. So those divisions reflected various peculiarities within the community. Now, of course, within the Jewish community, for the most part, you could talk about rabbinical Judaism, but there showed up from time to time various orientations which the mainstream Jewish community fiercely persecuted elsewhere. For instance, the Karaim, Karaites, Talmud-less mm-hmm. Jews, who were set upon and attacked by mainstream rabbinical Jews, say in Spain. They were denounced by the mainstream Jewish community, the Karaim were, both to the Muslims in Spain and to the Christians. They were pursued and hounded down, not to the Commonwealth. If you were a Hasidim in the Commonwealth, that was all right. This is where true pluralism applied, even in the Jewish community, which tended to be rather well, thus you put together and well put together and hermetic in a way. Another remark about the Jewish community is the Jewish nobility, or rather its lack. Some said, well, you know, the Tatars had nobility, Muslims with coats of arms, yes, so did the Scots. Once the parliament agreed to recognize your foreign nobility, there was a special mm-hmm. act of parliament, mm-hmm. which entailed some jumping through hoops. But it was possible. Scots who became Polish patriots naturally also sometimes were awarded nobility. What about the Jewish community? Well, there were a few Jews who kept their Judaism and they were noble, for instance. Ephraimovich, who was basically the crown chancellor of the exchequer, so the guy in charge of treasury under Casimir the Great. His confession was Judaism, but he was a Polish nobleman. I think his coat of arms was Leniwa, if I recall correctly. In any event, why so few? Well, that's because by the constitution of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, if a Jew converted to Roman Catholicism, he was automatically a noble. So there is an encyclopedia of Polish nobility of Jewish origin. Also, if you look at old Harari books from the Grand Duchy, you'll see about 5 to 10%, depending on the county, of people who are listed in those books with their coats of arms, but it says Znaofitów, of the Neophytes. You know, the old nobility has elaborate trees with many generations, and here is a dude and his two sons. Yeah. And it says Znaofitów, and usually a footnote, the constitution of whatever, statuty litewskie, the constitution of whatever, whatever paragraph. So, in other words, if you were Jewish and you wanted to become a part of the elite that voted not just within the Jewish community but nationwide, the road was open, but the price was conversion. The Tatars didn't have to do it, meaning they stayed Muslim. Of course, after a couple hundreds of years, you have people like Mustafa, who are today called Muszyński. They don't even know about it, but that's okay. How it was under communism, everybody forgot everything. Most people don't even know their coats of arms. Oh, horror. In any event, as far as royal towns and arrangements between Christians and Jews, there was a difference between, of course, the treatment of each autonomous group. There was, in terms of ethnicity, because, say, if you settled based on a Marburg law as a German settler from Westphalia, mm-hmm. you would mm-hmm. be treated differently mm-hmm. if an arrangement which allowed you to arrive and live in, say, the royal crown lands, and you were from Saxony because there was some other arrangement. There was a lot of diversity and a lot of medieval legal mm-hmm. considerations depending upon your confession, your ethnicity, and your legal status. Not only as a freeman, as you said. By the way, what was egregiously missing was royal peasants who enjoyed a different status and free farmers who also could bear arms. Mm-hmm. For instance, in Kurpia, in the Kurpia region up north toward Pomerania, this was a famous spot for archers and later sharpshooters. And they still do that, by the way. So they've carried on the tradition for a long time. They were also allowed weapons, which made them free, and they were mm-hmm. not nobility, mm-hmm. not to be confused with petty nobility. Mm-hmm. Petty nobility meant you served, you protected the nation, you were a nobleman. That meant you had 40 acres and a mule, basically. They were rather poor. But you served, you fought, that's all that was necessary. As I said, it's extremely delightful to talk about it because it's so deeply buried in history that hardly anybody knows or remembers anything, including historians who tend to follow trends and fashions. I'm glad you don't. You're resurrecting. You're like an archaeologist in this endeavor. I wanted to mention a few things about royal towns and their inhabitants. So there was not only differentiation based on a guild, social status and ethnic background and confessional origin, there was also a legal differentiation between various groups. Most of the time in the municipal authorities enjoyed the right to persecute people who transgressed in towns. But if you were a Scot, a Jew, an Armenian, or a Tatar, they couldn't, which was a bone of contention. Mm-hmm. And it oftentimes could lead to altercations, even sometimes riots in towns. So the way the king fixed things was there was a royal starosta grodzki, mm-hmm. county supervisor, And he took care of, well, quarrels between various groups, not only Jews, but also Jews and Christians. He was supposed to be impartial. Sometimes, to prevent rioting, he was not exactly impartial toward a group that constituted an absolute minority. I am also glad you mentioned Krakow. And case studies again. Krakow, the royal capital in medieval Poland after Gniezno and Poznań, and Płock. Płock was Poland's capital for about 40 years or so. Yes. under Bolesław the Rymów and his successors. So Krakow was peculiar because it attracted a majority of burghers, and in particular among the patriciate and the most prominent people, who were Germans. They brought with them from Western Europe some of the animosity that caused the Jewish people to move to Poland. That balance was redressed only through drastic means when the burghers of Krakow, German burghers of Krakow, supported a usurping Czech monarch, Bohemian monarch, and there was a popular uprising against the Germans to favor Ladislas the Elbow, because he was a short guy. That's what was. Anyway. And then the German patriciate was put to the test by the rebellious people of Krakow, who were Polish. So if you wanted to live, all you had to do was repeat Soczewica koło Mielenowy. If you didn't, that means you were a traitor to the king. And to Poland, yes. And as I said, that didn't target Jews. That targeted people who were in fact, instrumental in bringing altercations between the Jewish community and Christian burghers in Krakow. The enormous success of private towns was because this was competition. The magnates, people who owned the towns, were interested in profit, and they arranged their towns accordingly. Also, they didn't have to be fair. I mean, it is an extreme example to use a Muscovite defector who immediately turned anti-Jewish. Why? Because no Jew was allowed in the Muscovite state, period. Mm-hmm. All Jews who appeared in the Muscovite state were usually slaves, and if they were not tough enough, captured in the Commonwealth. If they were not tough enough, they would convert to Orthodoxy, and then there was no way back. If they held out, they would be bought back by Poland, by the Commonwealth, Poland-Lithuania, Ruthenia. Well, the idea of private towns endured, and the practice, into the 20th century. Professor Andrzej Nowak's wife's grandfather was a proud owner of Ziemia Tycze, which is outside of Białystok. And the Tsarist authorities would complain to him that there were not enough lamps, or that Jews were radicals in that town, and some other stuff. He no longer had a privilege or the right to maintain a police force, because obviously Poland had been partitioned. But nonetheless, the Tsarist Russian governor of occupied Poland, or gubernia, or given gubernia, would moan to him. If there was anything wrong going on in Ziemia Tycze, the authorities would come to him and say, "Oh, it's your town, what the heck is going on?" Oh, indeed, because the Tsar, unlike the communists and the Nazis, respected private property. As bad as he was, everything except for Free Poland that came afterwards was much more horrible, including, or maybe especially, for the Jews. Once again, I'd like to Thank you, and open the floor for questions. Yay!
I think Hoda Kevi said everything I wish I had said. Questions?
You said everything.
Yeah. You, then.
Okay. That would be me, no?
Whatever.
There is an excellent book on this subject, which is a historical atlas. It was put together by the University of Toronto and the University of Seattle together, a joint venture, which shows also the history of how the Polish Jewry was spreading through the Commonwealth. Very interesting one. And it shows, by the way, that Warsaw was the largest Jewish community in Europe, as a matter of fact, by the end of 19th century, which is
in absolute numbers. Absolute numbers, right? Yeah.
300,000 over 900,000 population. But I was going to make. I have a question for you, actually. When we're looking at the royal towns and private towns, you know, private town was established on private property. So the owner of that land could make decisions whether to enlarge the city or not to enlarge it, you know, and he could allow, you know, more people or less people. Royal towns had very definite borders. Mm-hmm. So if someone wanted to get a piece of property, Poland was the individual property law country, mm-hmm. not tribal one, like in Russia, everything belonged to the Tsar, right? In order for the Jew, or for Jewish family to settle, for example, in Warsaw, or even in Krakow itself, you know, or smaller towns, you know, to get a piece of property was very difficult, because there were owners, and not all owners would be willing to sell the property, right? So the population of populating the royal cities by the Jews were more difficult because the boundaries were very well defined, right? This is one thing. And of course, the inhabitants that were living in those cities, they were trying to defend from any threat they considered, mm-hmm. right? Very often it was prejudice, and very often it was, you know, just simply...
It was all competition. They didn't want competition from
everywhere.
Yeah.
But I think you could look also from this perspective, you know, that for example, Warsaw couldn't grow fast, you know, unless the suburban area, boroughs, were incorporated into the city limits, right? I think this is something that's worth looking into. And one another comment, Jews had individual freedom in Poland. Right.
Yeah.
They could move freely
yes.
from place to place, and the only limitation they had, they couldn't freely buy the land, because the land was...
There was a restriction on that,
could
yeah.
be only by nobility.
But there was also local variation in that restriction.
And many actually Jews, well, the illiteracy among the Jews didn't exist at this time. And very often they were very educated, very well educated, you know, in mathematics, finance, you name it. No wonder that, you know, Abramovich was like a treasurer of the Grand Duchy of Lithuania, right? This is the man you were...
Sorry, I have to ask a question, because we only
yes.
have one more minute left.
Oh, I see, okay.
Yes. So
all
you'll right. be the last person
yes.
asking questions.
Yes. And, you know, my question is, you know, is this... Do you because they worked with nobility so easily and helped to grow businesses. You know. This may be was the inspiration for nobility to work very closely with the Jews.
Yeah, that's,
you know.
That's definitely a factor. I mean, Jews were one of the groups in Poland that actually you'd consider free labor, as in they were they could switch, like the peasants, a lot of peasants, not all the peasants, but most of the peasantry in St. Ruthenia could not become, couldn't leave their land and become free burgers or whatnot. The Jews had the right to immigrate much more easily than, say, Ruthenian or some Polish peasants, not in the peasants we were earlier talking about. Okay, we'll do one more. Okay.
First of all, thank you so much. I think economic history is fascinating. do it. And it sounds wonderful because it seems, from what you were saying, that certain rules just apply across time, like incentives.
I think that's true.
Striking from everything you were saying. Anyway, my question would be this. Do you feel, I kept thinking about the rule of subsidiarity as I was listening to you, making distinctions between private and royal.
Mm-hmm.
And do you feel that there is a very definite, I was looking at those victims and pogroms, and I was also later thinking about towns that were 60% Jewish
mm-hmm.
in 1939. Didn't turn out well because there were more victims than those who could potentially help, obviously.
Yeah.
Would you say that, do you see a rule that closer relations between those who get to make decisions, the landlords, and the Jews, and all the townspeople, somehow correlate? I don't know if it correlates or if you feel there is causality with just regulations being imposed by the crown. Like, this is how you must behave towards those people, versus neighbors living together and the landlord saying,
I see where you're going.
Up close. I'm asking.
And I think
it's a leading question, but I am asking honestly.
I'm biased in this because I do like, local government and things like that. But yeah, I would say that that the relationship was much closer. And this book talks about it, and another the book on Apatu talks about how much easier it was in private cities to change rules, regulations, or deal with those type of problems. So this rule of subsidiarity, I think, was applied much better in private towns than royal towns. Yep. Okay. Oh, do you want to talk about it afterwards, or do you want to?
Let's talk afterwards.
Okay.
Well, go ahead.
Okay. Just ask.
Okay, so first of all,
I love.
PhD student who studies Jews in the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth.
I love your necklace, by the way.
Thank you.
Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth.
I know. Thanks. So anyway, I have two questions for you. One is about the kind of dichotomy between private and royal towns. I mean, if you talk about Krakow, for instance. I think it's by the 18th century, over half of it are Juridiki and Libertatia, these individual mm-hmm. enclaves or houses that are under private jurisdiction.
Right, yeah, yeah.
So is it fair to, say that there's either a royal town or a private town? How do you deal with that? My second question is maybe a little bit bigger, and you don't have to answer it all right now, I can talk to you after, but how do you define when you say there was a persecution or there was an expulsion? When you say that there, Jews were kicked out of a town, and there was a privileged non-tolerant Judaeus, do you take into account the fact that Jews often moved into a neighboring town where they got
a
privileged non-tolerant Christianus, which is pretty unique for...
Really? They got those? Did they get those privileges? Ooh, show me info on that.
Non-tolerant,
can you send me that? That'd be interesting. Maybe I remember reading that. Or just, persecutions, I'm not looking, so blood, on the individual level, it'd be like a blood libel, because that's obviously anti-Semitic or whatnot. It's obviously at a Jew, or riots against Jews and things like that. But if it's, a Jew is murdered and it's not really clear if it's because he's Jewish or not, I'm not taking something like that into account. And actually, sometimes with those blood libels, it seemed pretty clear that there was some type of economic motivation behind it. Yeah, there usually is. There was.
Yeah.
It was not because they thought.
When you don't know what it's about, it's about.
Yeah, yeah.
Money.
And you'd see there was a blood libel, and the courts are taking it seriously. And then you look at who's behind the courts, or whatever, and it's the guild. And with the local, like, so the noble enclaves within the towns, the Judaeki and all that. That's actually an interesting way of, like, perhaps if there were more of those in a town, in a royal city, it was more peaceful, it was more violent, maybe we can't. Yeah, that'd be interesting to look at. I like that. I'm gonna have to think about that more and do a little more research. Okay, thank you.